Hey everyone, I'm back at you. We're here again for another episode of Travel Thoughts. Today is another Thoughts on Culture. And this time, I'm going to be talking about the craving of culture shock. Last week, I mentioned a lot of excerpts from Full Tilt by Dervla Murphy. I'm also going to talk about her a little bit today. The other book I'm going to be working in is called The Art of Travel by Alain de Botton. And I probably butchered that a little bit, but bear with me, I guess. Today, we're focusing on the feelings of wanting to feel culture shock. If you're more well-traveled and maybe you've gone to places that are very different culturally from where you have grown up or where you're from, then you might be able to relate to this some bit. But basically, culture shock is when you go somewhere that is very different from what you are used to and you feel a sense of shock. So first off, I'll start by reading this excerpt from Full Tilt. Basically, if you didn't watch my last video, the memoir is about this young woman who cycles through the Middle East. Here she's talking about how she slowly adapted to the shocking culture versus how some other people have had to go about it. Here, I'll start for you. This evening, I also met a young Dutch couple who arrived in Kabul a fortnight ago on their first assignment abroad and who are still wondering what hit them. I must admit that I do see their point, and I'm duly grateful that I approached Afghanistan gradually. Had I flown directly from Dublin and landed in Kabul as a wide-eyed, sensitive, nostriled newcomer to the East, I too might well have been unable to appreciate the finer points of Afghan life and culture. As it is, during my 2 months traveling from Istanbul to Meshed, the roads became daily less road-like, the mountains higher, the atmosphere rarer, the clothes stranger, the chairs scarcer, the Muslims more Islamic, the sanitary arrangements more alarming, the weather hotter, the stench is stronger, and the food dirtier. By the time I arrived at the Afghan frontier, it seemed quite natural before a meal to scrape off the dried mud off the bread, pick the hairs out of the cheese, and remove the bugs from the sugar. I had also stopped registering the presence of fleas, the absence of cutlery, and the fact that I hadn't taken off my clothes or slept in a bed for 10 days. Okay, first off, I'll just say by everything she's describing here is probably much to the extremes of what the average person would experience on their yearly trip abroad or however often it is that you go. But keep in mind that she really put herself into the local scene. So that changes things a bit, but I love how she talks about, for obviously someone who flies somewhere, it's very overwhelming, but because she had slowly gone through the different countries and finally made her way there, she got used to everything, right? So for some people, culture shock can be a very negative experience, and understandably so. But for some of us, and even for me, there's been times where I've experienced culture shock. It almost becomes like this kind of addiction. Once you move past any fear or discomfort, that feeling of being immersed in something so different can be almost addicting. And this is what I'm going to be talking about a bit today, that craving for culture shock. So from here, I'm going to look at some excerpts from the other book that I mentioned at the beginning, which is The Art of Travel by Alain de Botton. And here, basically, his book takes in some ideas from other older travelers, painters, and the like. But the first excerpt I want to share has to do with the somewhat chaotic cultures that we can find ourselves in abroad. This one is from a traveler and he is in Egypt and he is French also. So I'm gonna just start off. Why did the chaos, the richness, so touch Flaubert? Because of his belief that life was fundamentally chaotic and that aside from art, all attempts to create order implied a censorious and prudish denial of our condition. He expressed his feelings to his mistress Louise Collet in a letter written during a trip to London in September 1851, only a few months after his return from Egypt. He says, "We've just come back from a walk in Highgate Cemetery. What a gross corruption of Egyptian and Etruscan architecture it all is. How neat and tidy it is. The people in there seem to have died wearing white gloves. I hate little gardens around graves, with well-raked flower beds and flowers in bloom. This antithesis has always seemed to me to have come out of a bad novel. So he goes on further to talk about how much he hates that clean and tidy cemetery. He does mention other examples of bars and restaurants that were also very unkept and clean, but how he really enjoyed it. I must say, his hatred on tidy things is a little bit harsh, and a lot of the things that is quoted from this man in the book are a little bit on the questionable side. But there's something here that I can relate to, and that is the love for chaos. The idea that as humans, we are inherently chaotic. We make mistakes. We can be vulgar. We can be outspoken, which perhaps are all associated with negative connotations, but this is all still part of being human. His argument is that an attempt to portray ourselves as perfect or tidy really hides our true nature. And when I think of this kind of chaos, I take myself to many places, as I've definitely been in a few chaotic ones, but I take myself to places where everything seems chaotic in relation to our Western thought, or in his case, European. When I arrived in Sri Lanka, for example, I felt culture shock pretty abruptly. It was the first place in Asia I'd been to. What did I notice at first? Lack of sidewalks, lack of obedience to road signals, and lots of ways in which our society operate was very different from what I was used to. By the time I had made it to India, though, I had kind of grown this love for this chaos, and I actually craved it. I remember a few times while I was in India, we went into maybe some fancier restaurants or shops. I really felt kind of strange. Which doesn't really make sense because obviously I'm used to these kinds of things, but it was like that wasn't what I wanted. I wanted to feel the shock. So just something, I don't know if that's something that you've experienced too. If you have, let me know. I think it's very interesting. But I suppose the main question from this excerpt is, are we being faithful to our human characteristics by trying to construct perfect, tidy buildings, societies, you know, whatever? Or do we actually thrive better in chaotic environments? Is that more natural for us? I don't know the answer to this yet, but at least for me, I find the experience of culture shock exhilarating and wonderful. I suppose it's my own version of adrenaline rush. I mean, I don't really go bungee jumping or whitewater rafting. So for me, I guess, you know, the exhilaration is in feeling like I am this outlier and everything else around me is new and not what I'm used to. If you're the same, let me know. Now I'm going to actually move back to Full Tilt by Murphy. And she's going to be talking about a few parallels about the different ways of going about similar problems. As you know, I said before, she travels through the Middle East. There's a lot of obviously Islamic influence there. In this instance, Dervla is actually referring to real poverty, not the inappropriately labeled poverty that I spoke about in my last video. So not simplicity, this is actual poverty where there is a lack of necessities. So here in this excerpt, she's talking about Muslims, beggars, and how that's sort of a kind of charity. On leaving Constantinople, where one spends a small fortune on beggars, I'd resolved to give nothing to anyone during the rest of the journey, lest I end up with a begging bowl myself. But of course, Persia has undermined that resolution. The pathetic wretches seen here simply can't be ignored. Many of them in towns and villages are lepers, diagnosed too late for treatment. Even if treatment were available in their area, which it often isn't, they're left to die slowly at home. So now I've got the problem worked out systematically. I reckon that by being a guest at my friend's house, I'm saving about a pound a day, which I distribute as bakshish, which is donations, essentially. This obviously is an oblique form of selfishness. One couldn't go home after a walk through Tehran and settle down to enjoy the luxuries of capitalism if one hadn't done something, however trivial, to alleviate the surrounding misery. Yet it's well to remember that this misery is not as total or as neglected as it appears to be. One of the religious duties of Muslims, as of Christians, is to give alms to the needy, and the vast majority of Muslims of every sect regularly fulfill this duty in proportion to their means. In effect, the citizens of these countries provide for their deprived brothers as generously as they do the taxpaying citizens of the welfare state, and the disparity between the circumstances of the disabled of Persia and the disabled of Britain is no greater than that the circumstances of the working men in the two countries. In fact, it may well be less, though the distribution of funds is more haphazard. Although the Muslim method of providing social services has the important virtue of maintaining a natural and human link between individuals, it is obviously more desirable to have citizens giving to beggars voluntarily out of compassion rather than to have them grumblingly paying taxes to an impersonal government, which dispenses what is left after its civil servants have been paid to unknown sufferers who are mere names in a filing cabinet. I'm not gonna say one way is right, one way is wrong. That's not what I'm here to do. But I'm here to just give you these things to think about, of course. What I love about what she writes here is how these different societies approach the same problem. Of course, Muslim society, which Dervla is passing through, is far more chaotic than her home Ireland. So their way of helping the poor is approached very differently. We might find the Muslim approach may be more haphazard and perhaps is not as functional or fair, but we can't stay blind that things like homelessness or poverty have been completely annihilated by our own tidy efforts, right? As the previous quote, Flaubert may label it as being tidy. Obviously, our way isn't perfect either, right? What I mean to bring this up is not to be so harsh in the way things are operated, because at first glance, that's how people may judge it as very harshly, and they may say it's wrong, but you know, there is still some function to it. And that's what she wanted to bring up, and that's what I really liked, is to have that openness to, okay, well, how is it working, right? And compare that to how we operate. It's very interesting. The next excerpt that I want to share, and this I find very, very interesting. Here we're going back to the previous book, The Art of Travel. The same gentleman, Flaubert, is speaking again, and he is talking about our nationality, which of course, as we all know, generally based on where we were born and where we grew up. But he is arguing something very different and very intriguing. So here goes. Flaubert's lifelong relationship with Egypt seems like an invitation to deepen and respect our own attraction to certain countries. From his adolescence onwards, Flaubert insisted that he was not French. His hatred of his nation and its people was so profound as to make a mockery of his civil status. Hence, he proposed a new method for ascribing nationality, not according to the country of a person's birth or ancestral origins, but instead according to the places to which he or she was attracted. Flipping forward like about a page. On his return from Egypt, Flaubert attempted to explain his theory of national identity, though not of species or gender, to Louise Colet. As to the idea of a native country, that is to say, a certain bit of ground traced out on a map and separated from other bits by a red or blue line. No. For me, my native country is the country I love, meaning the one that makes me dream, that makes me feel. I am as much Chinese as I am French, and I cannot rejoice about our victories over the Arabs because I am saddened by their defeats. I love those harsh, enduring, hardy people, the last of the primitives, who at midday lie down in the shade under the bellies of their camels and, while smoking their chibouks, poke fun at our good civilization, which quivers with rage over it. Again, his views are definitely quite stark and maybe very different to how we all generally think, but I do find some interest of them. Of course, now, if we truly want to embody a culture, we can of course emigrate, if possible, of course, and possibly become resident in a place of our choosing, if the authorities allow it, of course. But regardless of those administrative things, we would probably still be considered immigrants because we'll probably look different, maybe we act different. But what if nationality was something we could choose and change after exploring different places? I might be taking this a little bit too far, but if we had the ability to choose our nationality, which I think definitely speaks to our society right now in terms of how gender has come to be more fluid and in the past few years. I think, what if we took that kind of mindset here? So rather than being assigned something concrete, would having the ability to choose help diminish any prejudice or stereotypes about certain cultures? Maybe, maybe not. Maybe it would help us to all be more understanding of each other's differences. Again, these are all rhetorical questions, so to speak, but I don't necessarily want to answer what I'm asking here. I just want us to maybe think about and see, just open ourselves to some new ideas here. That's all I'll talk about today, guys. I know, another lengthy episode. I talk a lot, but I really wanted to talk about that craving for culture shock, which I definitely relate to a lot. If you do too, let me know. Let me know if you have any other thoughts about this strange idea of choosing our identity, our citizenship and nationality. If that is something you've thought about before or you're thinking about now, let me know. I think it's interesting to think about. Of course, I'll put the names of the two books that I've been talking about in the description below so you can look them up as well. I really suggest them. They were great reads. With all that said and done, if you like this video, like the video. If you are looking for more chats like this, stay tuned. I will be sharing more in the next few weeks. Thank you so much for watching and sticking around with me, and I will see you next week. Bye.